Good morning and welcome. As we gather for worship today, we want to say a happy Father's Day to all the dads that are out there this morning. If you're tuned in to the radio station this morning, thank you for tuning in to WIOE. If you're watching later on this morning on our Facebook page or YouTube or on WIOE.com, thank you for tuning in and being a part of worship. As we gather for worship this morning, if you're listening to us on the radio, one of the things that I've heard from folks listening on the radio that don't have a visual for what's happening in worship is they don't know who's doing what. So I just want to take a minute and say thank you this morning to our musicians. Richard Dick is on the organ this morning. Deb Bishop is on the piano. We have our singers that are here with us. We have John Kirkpatrick and Sarah Rode. We also have a liturgist this morning. I'll be reading to us our call to worship and our scripture today, Willis Ault. Our children's ministry director, Mandy Bailey, is going to be sharing with us a children's message here in just a moment. And also on our soundboard today is David Bailey. Couldn't quite get it there. Also, I want to say a huge thank you to Brian Walsh, Flying Brian, who is recording and also broadcasting this service on WIOE. So we get started this morning, just as a reminder, what we do on Mother's Day and on Father's Day is we highlight an important ministry of the church and give an opportunity to help support that ministry. And this Father's Day, we're going to be continuing the support through this second quarter as our mission focus, the Life Pump. This ministry will provide an important well in a village in Malawi, Africa. And if you would like to honor or remember your father this Father's Day through a gift, you can make that gift out to FUMC and mark that for Father's Day, and we'll make sure that that gets applied to that Life Pump ministry. So we begin this morning. I want to invite you to join me as we pray. God, we thank you for your presence among us as we gather for worship today, wherever we are. God, we pray that you would pour out your Holy Spirit upon us. Lord, that you would ignite the fire of passion for Jesus, love for the work that you've called us to do in sharing your message and spreading the kingdom of God in the ways that you've called us to do that. Guide us today, Lord, as we worship you. And we thank you in Jesus' name. Amen. I want to invite you to sing together God of the Ages as we start our time of worship.
Our hearts increase. Sing praises to God. Rejoice in his presence, for he is our God, a father to the fatherless, and the defender of all who need protection, the one in whom the lonely find a home, and the prisoner finds release. Bless the Lord, the God of our salvation, who sustains and strengthens us day after day. Let's worship God together.
Good morning. Happy Father's Day to all of those fathers out there. I want to say happy Father's Day to our biological dads, to our adopted dads, to our teachers, to our mentors, to our community members, to all people who act as fathers to us. We are so blessed in our church family to have so many wonderful men who can build us up and encourage us, and I thank you for that. Wanted to talk about something called symmetry today, and I'm going to do a little demonstration. I will do it quick, and for those of you on the radio, I will illustrate. So I have a piece of paper up here. I'm going to take some green paint, and I'm going to paint on one side of my, hold on, let me fix the paper real quick. Oh, thank you, Pastor Brian. Okay, so I'm going to make my green leaves on the left side of my paper. Now, I'm going to use my brown paint to paint a line down the left side of my paper. And the next thing I'm going to do is I'm going to fold my paper in half, and we're going to see what happens. So what you can see is that I have a tree. Hopefully you can see that. On the left side, I have green leaves and branches, and on the bottom, I have a strong, mighty tree trunk. And on the right side, I have the same thing because I folded my paper in half, and that's what symmetry is. And so, kids, I wanted you to think about that Jesus made us in symmetry to him. He made us just like him. And he calls us to be like him. He calls us to do the things that he did when he was here on the earth by loving people well. And parents, we get to do the same thing with our kids. Our kids biologically are symmetrical to us, but also they act as we act and they speak as we speak. So in this time more than ever, it's so important that we model to them how to love well as Jesus did. And I wanted to take a minute to bring up a song that's going to be sang by our praise team here at the end. I heard them practicing, and so I changed the end of this children's message to reflect that. I thought the words were so neat. So the song is called If We Are the Body, and it says this. It calls us, if we are Jesus's body, we need to reach out. If we are Jesus's body, our hands must heal. If we are Jesus's body, our words must teach. And if we are his body, then we need to go. Our feet need to go, and we need to love well. So I thought that was such a perfect song about being symmetrical to Jesus and to God, that we need to go out and love well. And so that takes a lot of courage and a lot of boldness. And I want to pray about that together as we leave the children's message today. Lord, thank you so much for making us symmetrical to you and for calling us to act symmetrical to you. We thank you so much for giving us the courage and the boldness to stand up for peace and for love and to help all people. And we pray that you would help us to do that in the days and weeks and months and years to come. Help us to love people well. Thank you, Lord. Amen.
Thank you, Mandy, for that children's message this morning. Many of you have started attending the drive-in service at our Connection campus, and you notice if you're able to see what we're doing this morning, but even from what you've heard this morning with the organ playing, if you're on the radio this morning, that we've relocated at our downtown campus indoors just because of the concern about rain. Not an easy decision to make. It turned out to be not too bad of a day outside, but again, it's just a reminder to me that no matter where we are, whether we're together in one place or whether we're spread out in many different places, whether we're at the downtown campus or we're at the Connection campus or we're at the lake, or no matter where we are, that as we come together, we are the church, the body of Christ. And one of the blessings of coming together as we're doing today is that we get to spend this time in worship. And an important part of what we do in worship is to spend time in prayer. And I love the fact that we include, as part of our prayer time, we'll start with a moment of silence. That way, whatever's on your heart this morning, there may be burdens that you're carrying, sins that you want to confess, things that are going on in your life that maybe are a celebration that you want to say thank you, God, for. We're going to spend that time in silence, followed up with some prayers that I will pray. And then as a body, as a church coming together, we'll join together and lift up the Lord's Prayer. So as we begin prayer, let's start with silence. God, as we breathe in your presence today, as we breathe out the worries, the cares, the trials, the troubles, Lord, thank you for your constant presence in our lives. Thank you that you walk with us through those times of difficulty. God, that you walk with us through those times of great joy. God, you walk with us in those in-between times when life is just normal. Lord, over the last 3 months, for most of us, life has been anything but normal. But God, thank you that you have walked with us through these times. And God, that you meet us right here, wherever we are today, listening on the radio, watching online, or a part of worship here in the sanctuary, helping to lead. God, thank you for meeting us right here. God, we thank you for the many ways that you are working in our lives, the many ways that you bless our lives. God, every good and perfect gift, the scriptures remind us, is a gift from you, and we're grateful for those many blessings that you pour out into our lives. And we celebrate those this morning, and we attribute them back to the one who brings those blessings. It is you, Lord, and we are so grateful. God, this morning, as we gather as the church, Lord, we know that there are many concerns, many cares, Lord, many burdens on people's hearts. And Lord, you see each one, you know each one so well. And God, we are grateful, first of all, that you know those cares. You're right there in the midst of whatever is going on in people's lives this morning. And God, that not only do you know what's going on, but your heart is for us. So God, we reach our hands out to those this morning who are hurting. And Lord, we pray that you would embrace them with your incredible love. Lord, that you would bring hope and encouragement and healing and strength into the lives of every person, Lord, who is struggling today. God, may they know in some way today that hope that we have in you, of your presence with us, bringing hope and life and encouragement. God, we thank you for, even though that things are difficult in our world today, God, that you're working in unique ways, Lord, to bring healing and hope. And so, Lord, we pray for our community here. We pray for our state, our nation. We pray for the world this morning. Lord, that your arms would reach out to those around our communities and our world today that are hurting. God, that you would bring healing and hope, that you would speak into the hearts of Lord, those who lead in different ways around our world today. God, that their hearts would be touched by your powerful love. God, in ways that only you can do, in only ways we can imagine that you can do. But God, we ask that you would work in the lives of our leaders. God, that their hearts would be awakened to your presence and to your call upon their lives and the important role that they play. God, as we look around our communities today, there are many who serve so faithfully in so many different ways, and we're grateful, Lord, for the work that they do, from our police officers, our firefighters, our paramedics, our school teachers, those that work in the medical profession, those that lead on our councils and our cities and communities. Lord, all of those that serve in so many different ways to bring hope and encouragement to our communities and to serve our communities. God, we're grateful for the work that they do, and we ask, God, that you would pour out your blessing upon them. God, give them strength, give them courage, Lord, give them wisdom as they serve faithfully. God, this morning we know that there are many who are serving in our armed forces around our world today. Some of them are in some very dangerous places. God, would you watch over them, keep them safe, and God, help them to know your presence with them wherever they are today. Guide them in the important work that they have before them. Give them great wisdom and compassion and care as they do the duties that they've been called to do. And Lord, we pray that you would bring them home to be with their families very soon. Lord, this morning as we celebrate dads, and as Mandy pointed out, not just biological fathers, but those that have had the influence in our lives as men, Lord, we thank you for those that you have placed in our lives, that you have blessed us with. And God, we pray for families today. God, that your hand would be upon families. Lord, that you would be with those families perhaps that are having difficulties today. Family relationships are strained. Lord, finances are strained. Health issues, God, that your hand would be upon our families today. And God, that they would know your presence with them. God, this morning we're grateful for the body of Christ. And this is just a very small snapshot of the larger picture of the church here in our country, but also around the world, that gathers for worship, just as we are doing today. God, we ask that you would pour out your Holy Spirit upon the church, the body of Christ. God, that you would awaken us to your incredible love, and God, that we would more and more share that love with those around us. God, we thank you for pastors, for church leaders, Lord, for all that are a part of the body of Christ today. And God, we ask that you would bless each one. God, this morning, again, we are grateful for the many ways that you bless our lives. And Lord, as we continue in our worship today, we lift this prayer that you taught your disciples to pray. Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done, on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our trespasses, as we forgive those who trespass against us. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom and the power and the glory forever. Amen.
Glory evermore. Grant us us wisdom, grant us courage, serving thee whom we adore.
This is a scripture reading from 2 Timothy chapter 1, verses 1 through 8. This letter is from Paul, chosen by the will of God to be an apostle of Jesus Christ. I have been sent out to tell others about the life he has promised through faith in Jesus Christ. I am writing to Timothy, my dear son. May God the Father and Christ Jesus our Lord give you grace, mercy, and peace. Timothy, I thank God for you, the God I serve with a clear conscience, just as my ancestors did, night and day. I constantly remember you in my prayers. I long to see you again, for I remember your tears as we parted. And I will be filled with joy when we are together again. I remember your genuine faith, for you share the faith that first filled your grandmother Lois and your mother Eunice, and I know that same faith continues strong in you. This is why I remind you to fan the flames the spiritual gift of God gave you when I laid my hands on you. For God has not given us a spirit of fear and timidity, but of power, love, and self-discipline. So never be ashamed to tell others about our Lord. And don't be ashamed of me either, even though I'm in prison for him. With the strength that God gives you, be ready to suffer with me for the sake of good news. The word of God for the people of God. Thank you.
Thanks be to God. Amen. Thank you, Willis. Appreciate you reading that scripture for us this morning. Would you join me once again in prayer? God, thank you for Scripture. Thank you for your holy word, that as we turn to Scripture this morning, as we've heard from the Psalms earlier on, as we've heard from this letter to Timothy, God, that you would speak to us those things you would have us hear. Lord, I pray that the words of my mouth and the meditations of our hearts would be pleasing in your sight, our great rock and redeemer. Amen. Well, again, happy Father's Day to those fathers out there, but also, as was mentioned earlier, the men in our lives who've been influential. Men in our lives, as well as our moms and important women in our lives, do a lot in helping to kind of shape and guide us through our lives. And I think back on my own life growing up and the influence that my dad had on me, as well as my mom, both of my parents. But then I also think of others, teachers that were important to me, leaders in the church, youth director leaders, and different people in the church. And even beyond that, into the community, some of the people that I kind of watched and thought, you know what, I like that. I think I might take on that characteristic or try to lean into that and be more and more like that. There are people all around us, especially in those growing up years when we're younger, that have such an important impact and are important in shaping who we are and who we become later on in life. And so as I think about fathers on this Father's Day, and I think about the important role that they play, it takes me back to my own time as a father, and those of you who are parents, and you've had children, and you think through those initial first moments as you begin to prepare for the child that's coming. And I remember especially that first child, our daughter Sarah, as Rebecca, my wife, and I prepared for Sarah's arrival, going to the doctor's appointments, going to Lamaze class, and just getting everything prepared and thinking, oh my goodness, I am going to be a parent. I'm going to be a father. And just the awesome wonder of that, but also the reality of the fear of that. And I think part of that fear, looking back on that, was thinking, okay, this child is going to look to her mother and me. She's going to look to both of us for some guidance, for some direction. And what we do in raising these children, and that first child's always the tough one because you think you have to do everything just perfectly and you never do. And as we prepared for that, thinking, what we do with this child will shape their future. And it's very much the case. And it's not just parents, as I mentioned, it's people who are influential in our lives as well. And as we look at this scripture reading, and this scripture reading is kind of unusual because this is oftentimes the scripture reading that's used during Mother's Day because it refers to Timothy, who this letter is written to. It refers to Timothy's mother and his grandmother and how influential the two of those ladies were in Timothy's life and bringing him up in the faith. But as you look at this particular opening to the second letter that Paul, writing from prison in Rome, wrote to Timothy, you hear the tenderness and you hear the closeness of this relationship between Paul and Timothy. And just to give you a little bit of a background of how Paul and Timothy connected, at a very, very young age, Timothy, growing up in the church in his hometown, his parents, his mother and grandmother were very influential in developing his faith. Paul came across Timothy on one of his missionary journeys, and he and Timothy clicked immediately. That's sort of the sense that we get from Scripture. And we see a little glimpse of that from Acts chapter 16, where Paul encounters Timothy. And so they connect, and Timothy becomes sort of a mentee to Paul and begins to follow Paul and learn from Paul. Now, Timothy's father, we don't know a whole lot about Timothy's father. We do know from Acts 16 that Timothy's father was Greek. He likely was not a believer. Mother and grandmother were both Jewish, and they had a belief in God. So we don't know a whole lot about Timothy's father. So we don't know what kind of influence or what kind of relationship Timothy had with his dad. But immediately we understand that there's a closeness that develops between Paul and Timothy. And Paul invites Timothy on some of the journeys that he takes, these missionary journeys. So Timothy is able to walk alongside Paul and kind of learn from Paul and sort of pattern his life after Paul. So Paul was very, very influential in Timothy's life. And so as these letters are written, these two letters, there's 1 Timothy and then 2 Timothy. We took a look at the beginning of 2 Timothy today. These two letters, we suspect, are about 4 years apart in length and distance from time. The first letter Paul wrote from prison. He was under house arrest in Rome. He had been led to Rome to go see Caesar, and things went bad. And then the second letter that we read from today, Paul is in chains in sort of a dungeon prison in Rome. And his future was very much in question. And he writes this letter to Timothy, and we get some of the flavor of that close relationship between Paul and Timothy as Paul writes to Timothy, and he says to Timothy, "Timothy, I would love it if you were able to come and visit me again." And he writes to Timothy saying, "Timothy, these are some things I want to leave you with. These are things," and I can imagine Paul thinking in his mind, "these are things that I have spoken to you about many, many times before, patterns of how to live out this walk with Jesus that I want you to understand." And as Paul writes this letter to Timothy, we get sort of a picture of a little bit of who Timothy is and sort of the timidity of this man. And he's a young man, but Paul says to him, "God's not given you a spirit of fear, but of love and of power and of a sound mind." So we get sort of a picture of who Timothy is and some of the trials and the difficulties that Timothy faced in his journey. And we hear Paul reminding Timothy that God's given you an important role to play. God's poured out his spirit upon you on the laying of hands, and he's given you these gifts and this important role to play in the church. And we learn later on in church history that Timothy ends up being the head of the church in Ephesus, and he played an incredibly important role in leading the church. But in this moment, as Paul is writing to Timothy and reminding him, kind of like a dad would sort of pull a child close to him and kind of coach the child and say, "Remember these things. First of all, Timothy, remember who you are in Christ. Remember what God has done in your life. Remember the blessing of having faith. Remember the incredible blessing of God's presence with you each moment. And then this is what God's called you to do from this point, to go out into this world and to share that faith with others." So we've been walking over the last many weeks. We're coming close to the end of this sermon series, talking about what do you do when you don't know what to do. And we've looked at a lot of different things pertaining to different scriptures about how to respond in situations where I don't know. And we certainly have been walking in times where we've hit that reality. I don't know what to do in this situation. And in this particular time that we're in right now, we're still dealing with the results of the coronavirus, this pandemic that we're continuing to see flare-ups in, and communities trying to come back together. I was just talking earlier to some of our folks here about going out into public settings where there's a lot of people that are gathered. I went to a particular setting yesterday with my mask around my neck, and I was ready to put my mask on, and just being honest here, and I walk in and I see nobody wearing masks, and I'm thinking, okay, do I want to put a mask on right now with nobody wearing a mask? What do you do when you don't know what to do? And then we're also facing a time where the reality of some of the injustices that we have seen, that we have lived with for so many years, and as I mentioned a couple of weeks ago, that seem for us anyway, us that are not the objects of the injustice, that seem to kind of go under the radar, and then things happen and they come back out and it's like, that's ugly. What do you do when you don't know what to do? And some of us are in the position of, I don't even want to look at that. I don't want to deal with that. Some of us are in the position of, why do you bring this up? Why don't you just stop? But the reality is we've hit this wall once again. And there's a reason that wall is there. Just as there's a reason why we have to take precautions with the coronavirus, because if we don't, we'll see people become sick and we'll overwhelm our health system. If we don't face the wall of racism, prejudice, and I know some of you are thinking right now, oh great, here we go. If we don't face those, we will miss this incredible opportunity to shine forth what Paul is reminding Timothy about in his letter. His letter is not specifically about racism, but his letter is about how we can share the faith that we have in Jesus. And if we miss this opportunity, it will be a horribly missed opportunity to be able to share the faith that we have in real practical ways. Because I can talk about it, and I do talk about it, blah, blah, blah. I talk about it all the time. And that's important. What we say is incredibly important. The words that we share, the experiences that we've had with our faith in Christ, all of those things that we share verbally are so important. All of those things that we communicate to others in different ways are so important. But here's a much huger important thing that I'm beginning to realize more and more. It's what we don't say and how we live our lives. And one of the ways that I see that happening currently in what we don't say, and it's kind of a passive-aggressive sort of, here you go, is in social media. And I know many people are on social media, and they use social media to push forward some of their ideas. And in this way, you don't have to speak face-to-face with somebody. It's really easy to write something, to respond in a certain way. And I've had to step back, to be honest with you. I've had to step back. Because there's been times when I've seen things on social media, or I've heard people say certain things, or I've seen something on the news, and I want to react to it. And that reaction in and of itself may not be a bad thing, but when it doesn't go through the filter of my faith, and it's just a raw emotion coming out, boy, it does a lot of damage. And as Paul writes this letter to Timothy, Timothy, my son, the one who I love, who I've worked with for many, many months now. And I've shown you what it is to walk with Jesus and how Jesus has had this incredible impact and effect on your life. Timothy, remember. Remember who you are. You are a child of God, created in God's image to shine forth the love of God in the ways that God's gifted you. And it is so easy for Timothy, it is so easy for us to know that, but then just kind of let it go and just get on with life. And I'm sure things hit Timothy, and Timothy went into auto drive, and he kind of pushed that to the side, and he thought, you know what, that's too hard. I don't want to deal with that. And as Paul reminds Timothy, God's given you this incredible gift to share with the world around you. And he called Timothy to continue, in spite of the fear, in spite of the doubts, in spite of Timothy's age, to continue to make known that good news message. You and I have the opportunity, not in and of ourselves, not in and of our own strength or our own power, but you and I have the ability to be able to share that faith with those around us in the unique ways that we have to do that. Mandy shared with us in a children's message, I think it was last week, about the ripple effect. When you throw a rock or an object into the water, the ripple effect goes out. The same thing with our lives. Even if you don't think there's anybody in your life that you really have an impact on, all of us do. People are constantly watching each other, listening to each other to see what we're doing. And the ripple effect is a real deal. And as we celebrate Father's Day today, that ripple effect has a profound effect when it comes to parents on our children. But in the same way, in the body of Christ, this community of faith, what we say, what we do, and who we rely on makes a huge, huge impact on those around us. So my encouragement to us today, what's the point? My encouragement to you today that Paul shares with Timothy is remember who you are, and remember to fan into flame the gift of God that you received in the laying on of hands. For Timothy, that was the gift of being able to share the gospel, to preach the good news of Jesus, to pastor the church, to be a leader in the church. Every single one of us has that sphere of influence and has those gifts that God's given to us to be able to share with those around us, to bring hope and to bring love. Every single one of us have that. And how tempting and how difficult it can be to keep fanning into flame that gift of God. So that's my encouragement to us today, is to fan into flame the gift of God that was given to you. Maybe not necessarily with the physical laying on of hands, but when you came to faith in Jesus and you said yes to Jesus, you said, Lord, my life is yours. Have your way in me. And that's my prayer for us. And I think my prayer for us, especially in those times when things get really, really tough and we have no clue what to do, and sort of those defense reactions come in and we're grabbing for whatever we can get a hold of, my encouragement to us is to stop, to get before God. Say, God, I'm not liking this. Show me what your plan is. And God, fill me with your Spirit. We talked about Pentecost a few weeks ago, the gift that God has given to us to be with us always, to lead us and to guide us into all truth. And to say, Lord, fill me with your Holy Spirit and guide me by your Spirit. And for some of us, it may just be a matter of taking 5 seconds and breathing in and breathing out before we respond to whatever it is that's going on. But each one of us has the important role, whether we want to accept that role or not. As I fathered the children that God blessed us with, and I look back on that, I think, boy, I really blew that. I shouldn't have done that. Why did I say that? And I think back on the influence that I've had on my children, and I think about my own dad and the influence he had on me. Every single one of us have that influence on someone else. And we have the opportunity to be able to share the faith that Timothy got to share with a lot of people, Paul got to share with a lot of people, and not just words. Words are a wonderful thing, but sometimes words fall short. As we share this faith with others, let's share that love that God has poured out so freely upon us. So happy Father's Day to the guys. And as we think about the men in our lives who've had a great impact on our lives, the good stuff, but also the bad stuff, we're reminded today of the impact that we can have, not just on our children, but upon those that God places within our life and within our sphere. Let's share the love of Jesus, that incredible faith that we have. Let's share that love every single moment. God, I thank you for these reminders from Scripture of your incredible work that you do through the church, through the body of Christ, and how you place people in our lives, teachers, coaches, pastors, youth leaders, parents, guardians, special people in our lives that speak truth, that help us to know what it is to be a good human being. Thank you, God, for those special people in our lives. And God, remind us from moment to moment as we walk through this journey of life that you give us opportunities to share that love, to share that faith, just as we hear about characters in the Scriptures sharing that faith. So God, pour into us your Holy Spirit. God, and guide us, fan into flame within us as we pursue you, those gifts that you've given to us, to be able to reach out to those that are downtrodden, to be able to embrace those that are hurting and lonely, to be able to lift up those who are oppressed and are having incredibly difficult times because of the surrounding circumstances. God, give us your grace to be able to be the hands and the feet of Jesus in a world that needs to know that there's hope. We pray and we thank you in Jesus' name. Sing with me as we close this time together. We are the body. Worship as we've gathered today. Go out into this world that needs to know that there's hope. Let your hands bring the healing that's needed. Your arms wrap around those that are hurting. Your feet going to those places that are in need of hope and encouragement, and your words, and not just your words, but your actions, sharing that incredible faith that we have in our risen Jesus through the power of the Holy Spirit present with us. Go into this world filled with His Spirit. God bless you. Thank you for worshiping with us today.